Okay, Ephesians chapter 4, verse 17. And we're going to read all the way through the end of verse 32 up against chapter 5. It says this. Now this I say and testify in the Lord, that you must no longer walk as the Gentiles do in the futility of their minds. They're darkened in their understanding, alienated from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them due to the hardness of their heart. They've become callous and have given themselves up to sensuality, greedy to practice every kind of impurity. But that is not the way that you learned in Christ. Assuming that you've heard about him, were taught in him as the truth is in Jesus, to put off the old self, which belongs to you. Belongs to your former matter of life and is corrupt through deceitful desires, and to be renewed in the spirit of your minds, and to put on the new self created after the likeness of God in the true righteousness and holiness. Therefore, having put away falsehood, let each of you speak the truth with his neighbor, for we are members of one another. Be angry and do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your anger, and give no opportunity to the devil. Let the thief no longer steal, but rather let him labor, doing honest work with his own hands, that he may have something to share with anyone in need. Let no corrupting thing come out of your mouths, but only such as is good for the building up as fits the occasion, that it may give grace to those who hear. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and slander be put away from you, along with all malice. Be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another as God in Christ forgave you. This is God's word to us. Father, in the name of Jesus, I ask that you would help us to live as your children, that you would awaken our hearts, our minds to the reality of your kingdom, to the reality of your purpose for us in this earth. In Jesus' name, everybody say amen. Amen. I know that was a lot of text. If you're new here, it's because we're blasting through the book of Ephesians in kind of a fast, slow motion. So we're taking huge chunks of scripture, but taking our time getting through the book. And so today what we're going to talk about is how we are chosen by God to live like we're chosen. And I'm going to talk about rules, relationship, and a robe. First about rules. We have this desire to take these statements one by one and to lift them out and to apply them as rules for our life. Now, if you're new to Jesus and you're like, I've never had that temptation, the temptation is going to come to you. There will be a time where God writes something on your heart or inspires something in you, and you're going to try and follow it and likely not live up to it as well as you think you would. But you're going to start requiring that of other people as well. And then you're going to hold them accountable to a standard that you weren't even able to hold yourself accountable to. Now, this isn't just a problem from the Old Testament or the people who were before Jesus, but it's a problem that all of us have because it's a human problem. It's a problem of pride. And what we do is, what I want to do is I want to approach this a little bit differently than I've ever approached it before. And instead of taking it kind of commendation at commendation, encouragement by encouragement, is I want to lift this off the page and look at it all together. I broke down actually 4 and 5 into all of the different parts. And I was like, what is the commonality? What is the commonality here? What is God getting at? Instead of each individual thing that he's asking me to do, that I'm supposed to live up to each individual thing, which, by the way, they're good things. Right? Like, if you look at this, you know, Christianity is a bunch of rules, you might hear, and Christianity is a bunch of problems, you might say, and it's all these. But if you look at it, it's pretty reasonable. It's like, how about you don't lie about each other and you stop attacking one another? How about you tell the truth to each other? How about you love one another? How about you put on kindness and be tenderhearted and forgiving? Man, the Bible's rules are so outrageous. Can you believe what God expects of us? That we would be good to him and good to each other? Right? It's not so outrageous when you start looking at it. It's what we do with it that makes it outrageous. It's when we make it the basis of our righteousness that's the problem. And so as I was picking it up and I broke it all the way down and I was looking at it, I was like, God, what is it that you want us to know from this? And I think the big idea here is live like you're chosen. Remember who you are. If you recall at the beginning of the series on Ephesians, the first three chapters deal with doctrine. It deals with the ideas of who God is and who mankind is and what God has done on our behalf. And the second three chapters are often understood to be the way that we respond to the first three chapters. But even that's a little bit of a new idea. That's kind of an American Western Christianity approach of taking this, because to the people who were reading this the first time, they didn't separate out doctrine from lifestyle. Their beliefs were directly tied to their behavior, and they didn't think they were at all separate. So if you acted a certain way, it's because you believe a certain thing. But we like to be able to say, oh, that's not who I am, that's not what I believe, and separate ourselves from our behavior. But the reality is, all of our behavior reflects something that we believe, even when it's embarrassing. Even when it's embarrassing. Sometimes, like when I cut the guy off earlier this week and I was just mad, I don't actually believe that I'm better than him, but in that moment, I believed I was better than him. I believed that where I had to be was more important than where he had to be. My behavior was tied to a belief, and that's always true. And I believe what Paul is trying to do is not lay out a bunch of rules, because if we lay this out and understand it as a whole bunch of rules, we might actually miss the thing that's not explicitly stated in there. And you're like, I met the requirements that Paul gave me in Ephesians chapter 4, but you might miss what the Spirit of God is trying to lead you in today. So I think the bigger idea, and I've got a video to help illustrate this, is that you've got to remember who you are. Paul's saying, remember who you are. With your sexual self, with your emotional self, with your physical self, remember who you are.
Sure do, your Mufasa's boy. Bye.
Hey, wait! You knew my father?
Correction, I know your father.
I hate to tell you this, but he died a long time ago.
Nope, wrong again!
He's alive, and I'll show him to you. You follow old Rafiki, he knows the way. Come on!
Don't dawdle! Hurry up!
Hey, whoa, wait!
Come on!
Would you slow down?
Stop!
That's not my father. It's just my reflection.
No. Look hard. You see, he lives in you.
How can I go back? I'm not who I used to be.
Remember who you are. You are my son and the one true king. Remember who you are.
No, please, don't leave me.
Remember.
Father!
Father! Don't leave me.
So we could start a small group and talk about how this isn't a perfect metaphor, because God doesn't leave us like that. He gives us his Holy Spirit. He doesn't withdraw. The answer isn't looking inside, and the answer isn't being who you used to be, but it does come down to remembering God and remembering who we are. I think an apt summary is to live like royalty. If you've been chosen, adopted, and brought to life, as we've been talking about in Ephesians chapter 1 and 2, that makes you the son of, or the son of, or the daughter of God. And he's saying, don't live like you used to live, with the mindset that you used to have. No judgment on them for acting like them, but for you, who's now a child of God, don't live like you're not a child of God. But we've been invited into this relationship where the Spirit of God wants to dwell in us and compel us towards good works. To leverage your personality, to leverage your manner of life and your way of being and your experiences for the glory of God. To awaken inside of you the purpose that he's created you with and for. But if we forget who we are, we'll just default back to what we used to be and the way we used to behave. I still, when I walk into my parents' house, and the adults struggle with this, I go straight to the chip cabinet and start eating without thinking. Don't even get the refrigerator for Andrew. So when I go back into my parents' house, I revert back to how I was when I was 18. I want to pick the fights I picked when I was 18. I want to eat the foods I ate when I was 18. I want I go back into that other way of life. And I'm sure that's confusing for my kids, because they know me not as that, but they know me as somebody very far removed from that life. And Paul's like, don't fall back into that other way of life, but live a life empowered by and filled by the Spirit. And in everything you do, remember who you are. Remember that you're chosen. Live like you're chosen. I was talking to a friend of mine, and we had some really difficult conversations about race and reconciliation and privilege and all those kinds of things last year during 2020. My friend is black, and we were talking about this sermon. It's going to be important in just a second. I don't just throw that. I've got a black friend. It wasn't one of those. It wasn't one of those. I don't want people to think that it was one of those, because that might create some weird culture. We're new as a church. I don't want you getting confused. That's not what I was just saying. It'll make... That's not what I was saying. But my friend and I were talking about this passage together, and we were wrestling with the reality and wrestling with this question of remembering who we are and walking like we're chosen. And he goes, hey, it's like I'm privileged too. I was like, yeah. It's like, if anyone is in Christ, he's a new creation. The old is gone. The new has come. And the new brings with it certain privilege. And the privilege that it brings is a depth of relationship with our Father in heaven that allows us to walk into every and any circumstance knowing that we're loved. Now, it doesn't solve all the problems in the horizontal plane. But it gives me endurance and hope in the midst of difficulty. It stirs my heart with anticipation of the goodness of God being revealed in this life in a way that doesn't exist for me if I don't have the privilege of that relationship. So we've got this depth of relationship to carry us through every kind of thing. And the Spirit of God is walking with us. He dwells inside of us to lead us and guide us and to say, hey, maybe it's time to close your computer for the day. Hey, maybe it's time to change the channel. Maybe it's time just to chill out and stay in this lane and take 30 extra seconds to get to work this morning. Maybe it's time to apologize or to repent for misspeaking. Maybe it's time to to give to this thing that I've been trying to inspire you to give to. Maybe it's time to walk into the fullness of his relationship with you. Maybe it's time to crack it open and try the 5 for 5 and see if God would speak to you. Yeah. But the Spirit of God leads us and guides us like this relationally, not on the basis of rules. The rules of God have always been given in the context of trying to teach people how to have a relationship. And I can't go into too much detail here, but even the Ten Commandments in Exodus chapter 20, right before that, in Exodus chapter 19, God says something to Moses that is oftentimes missed by people, and it's this. He says, I want to be your God, and I want for you to be my people, and I want you to be distinct in all the earth by the way that you relate to me and in the ways that you relate to one another. And that's going to require that you live a little bit differently. And here's how you can live a little bit differently. And he offers the Ten Commandments. He didn't just come swinging with a whole bunch of rules. He started with relationship. He started with, I want you to know me, and I want you to know each other in a way that other societies don't work well together. And this was a group of people who were coming out of generations of slavery, and they were going to go out, and they were going to have to rule themselves and govern themselves and figure out how they were going to walk together and live together and die together. And God's like, this is how you're going to do it, and this is how you're going to do it differently. I'm giving you the cheat codes ahead of time. And so this is how you can relate well to one another. But if you violate these things, it'll be a train wreck. It'll be a dumpster fire. And indeed, we see that dumpster fire over and over and over again. And in our own lives, we see the dumpster fire over and over and over and over again. Yes. When we steer away from the rules that God has so generously given us to cultivate relationships so that we can be led to what is higher and better. This one verse in particular stands out to me, where Paul says, put on the new self, created to be like God in righteousness and holiness. He's, you know, the thing about our clothes is that we have to put them on every day. And so we're mindful of what we're putting on, and we put on certain clothes depending on what we're doing. If you're going to the gym, you've got certain gym clothes. If you're going to the office, you've got certain office clothes. If you're going on a date, you put on certain date clothes. So different times require different kinds of clothes. And Paul's saying, no matter what you got going on in your life, put on these clothes. Put on the clothes of righteousness. Put on the clothes of holiness. Put on the clothes of remembering who you are in God. Remember that you're chosen. And if you're like, where's the chosen thing in this passage that he keeps talking about? The thing is, it's this passage, this chunk of scriptures that we're looking at today and we're asking God about today isn't separate from his treatise on unity in the beginning of chapter 4. And it's not separate from what he said about being chosen in chapter 1, in chapter 1 and chapter 2. It's all together. It's one piece. It's more like a stew than a plate that's separated out in its parts. And we miss out on some of the beauty of Scripture when we eat it like it's all separate. And now this idea under the new life or whatever your separation was, we miss out on the beauty of this and kind of the heart of it and the intent of it and the power of it when we sever it from the rest of what Paul was talking about and the rest of his intent for us. When I think about putting things on, I can't help but think about the story of the prodigal son in Luke chapter 15. The prodigal son ran from his father and squandered his inheritance. It's actually my favorite passage to preach on, but I'm not gonna. So I'm skipping a whole lot of my most favorite parts of the verse to get to the very end where the son and the father are standing in front of each other again. The father had waited for the son, and the son finally came back after squandering everything, and he was feeding pigs, which is pretty humiliating for a Jewish person, especially in that time. And now his father welcomes him, embraces him, kisses him, gives him a ring and a robe and sandals. The ring as a seal of his love, the robe to cover his offenses. And so he was going to make sure that his son who ran off and acted a fool and ruined his life was going to look exactly like his son who never left. There was going to be no distinguishing between the two of them from afar. There's going to be no distinguishing between the two of them when you drew close to them because they were clothed the same way. And so it doesn't matter how bad you've been, how far you've run, what you've done or what you've given up, or you came and left and came and left. It doesn't matter. God is ready to put the robe on his son and welcome his son and his daughter back into his house. And he's going to make sure that there's no different. And he gave him sandals so that he was going to walk in the purposes of his father instead of his own purposes from that point on. Okay? But here's the thing. The son, as beautiful as that story is, and I love it so much, because it shows the faithfulness of God. And in fact, I don't even like the title, the prodigal son. So that's crossed out in my Bible, because the prodigal son isn't what Jesus called him. A more encouraging maybe version of the story is to call him the son who returned. The son, the father, welcome home. Maybe the faithful father, I think, is what Keller calls him. Right? You could call it a whole lot of things, because in heaven, that young man would not be regarded as the prodigal. He'd be regarded as a son. And sometimes we have a bad habit of titling ourselves by what we used to be instead of what God has made us into. Sometimes we have even a worse habit of identifying other people by what they used to be instead of who God is making them into. Maybe you came out of a lifestyle and you still identify yourself as that lifestyle. Maybe you've had certain struggles in your life, but you still identify with yourself primarily by those struggles instead of the freedom that God wants to bring you into. And I'm not talking about lying, like a word of faith thing where it's like you deny the struggles that you have and by just putting a happy title on it and like, I'm not struggling, I'm strong. No, like I'm struggling, but because of what Jesus has done, I know that I've got a robe on. The robe represents the forgiveness and the making righteous of his son. And that robe isn't something that puts itself on after that day. This is the part of the story that I so wish Jesus had expounded on, but he didn't, because it's actually our life. We've got to decide every single day, are we going to put the sandals on? Am I going to put the robe on? Am I going to leave the ring on today?
Wow. Come on.
And what's beautiful about this is that that's a decision we get to make every day. And, you know, I heard somebody say, like, people said, you're going to regret that in the morning if you do that. So he wakes up at 12 p.m. because he's like a cheat code. He doesn't wake up in the morning. He just wakes up the following afternoon. I told that really badly. It would have been funny. It doesn't matter what time you wake up. It doesn't matter what time you realize. You know, you wake up and you live like hell till 1 o'clock. It's you're like, I'm giving over to it. I might as well ride this out.
Come on.
Nah, put on the robe.
That's right.
Put on the robe. Put on the sandals.
Yes.
Put on the ring. Be kind to one another. Tender-hearted. Forgiving one another. As Christ has forgiven you, it's not too late. Put away falsehood. Speak the truth with his neighbor. We're members of one another. Be angry and don't sin. Don't let the sin go down on your anger. Don't give any opportunity to the devil. If you're a thief, stop it. Get a job and meet other people's needs. Do honest work. Don't let corrupting talk come out of your mouths, but only talk that builds up.
Yes.
Don't grieve the Holy Spirit of God who sealed you.
Yes.
Like a ring. For the day of redemption, let bitterness and wrath pass away. Doesn't that read a little bit different when we understand that it's an invitation to walk with Jesus and to walk with one another, to preserve a spirit of unity because we're chosen and not a means of attaining salvation or being good enough or proving our righteousness. It's the same idea. It's the same message. He hasn't changed. That's what he's inviting us into. That's the invitations of Ephesians chapter 4, 17 through 32. So we would walk in unity with one another, that we'd put the robe on, that we would prefer relationship. Let our relationship with the Spirit of God lead us and guide us. in our relationship with him and one another according to his loving kindness. Father, in the name of Jesus, I ask that you would help us. I thank you that the robe is from you, the ring is from you, the sandals are from you. So it's not a matter of creating it for ourselves, but just a matter of allowing you to place it on us and allowing you to lead us and guide us. We thank you for these rules. We thank you for these rules of life, for these guidelines that Paul has outlined for us. And God, we don't look past them without acknowledging them. But God, we ask that you would use them to reveal to us your greater plan and your greater purpose for us. That we wouldn't take your word and reduce it to a bunch of rules, but we would allow it to catalyze us, to catapult us into a deeper relationship with you according to your loving kindness. In Jesus' name, amen.